just to tell you about Chai and Mai, in case you're coming here for the first time, Chai and Mai happens twice a month. Third Sunday is over here at Parel College. First Sunday is at Prithvi Theatre in Jammu. And the best place to find us is on Facebook. All the events are posted there, and you can find links there, or you can send us an email if you want to be on our email list. The next one coming up, 2 weeks from now, at first Sunday of September, is on supercomputers in physics. So apparently, supercomputers are used to solve a lot of difficult problems in physics, and this is something very, very closely related to video games. So the moral of the story apparently is keep playing video games. Video games get better, supercomputers will get better. So that's going to be the next one at Prithvi. And after that, we have a whole series of interesting ones lined up, except I don't know exactly the one we are doing here a month from now. But apart from that, we have a month from now over here, in the next few days, we will finalize it. The first one in October is going to be on AstroSat. This is the first satellite, science satellite for astronomy being launched by India in the last week of September, and we will have somebody speak about it at Prithvi. In October over here, we are going to have one on all kinds of different geometries where angles of a triangle don't add up to 180 degrees and things like this. So different geometries is here. November 1 at Prithvi is our annual collaboration with the Mumbai Literature Festival, which happens in November. And there we will talk about Back to the Future. If you remember this movie Back to the future was 2015. So we will look at how 2015 compares with the future in the movie, and similarly how science fiction looks at the future in general. And over here, November 16th is our closest Sunday to Diwali, so it will be our Diwali specials where we will have experiments with light once more. Maybe we'll measure the speed of light, you know. That's what's planned. Again, as I said, the best way to find out is please go to our Facebook page, like it, you can get information about it. All the events are posted over there. And that means it's time to change over to today's talk, which is going to be on Pluto. It's a pleasure to introduce Professor Mayank Vahia. So, he has probably done the second most number of Chai and Mai. This is the fifth one, right? On something like this. He is in the Department of Astronomy and Astrophysics at AIFR with a wide range of interests, from experiments on corona, the space shuttle many years ago, coming, to looking at archaeo astronomy, to see how evidences from archaeology can help you look at astronomy thousands of years ago, from the Indus Valley script, and of course, even at the planetarium also for a while as a director. So, more about planets and Pluto.
This is what Pluto would have looked like, the landscape of Pluto would have looked like. The sun is about 400 times brighter than it is the full moon on Earth, so you would certainly more than see your shadows and so on. So you would have been able to see your shadow quite comfortably on the moon. You would probably have been able to read also on the moon, on Pluto, using sunlight. And this is of course the moon of Pluto, about which we will talk. So it's worth remembering that even though it's very, very far away, the sun is not an unimportant object as far as Pluto is concerned. Pluto of course goes around the sun and so on, but this is what it would look like. The other interesting feature, and something that you are completely not expecting, is this kind of mountains that they would have seen. This is not exactly a photograph, by the way, get it right. This is not exactly a photograph, but from the photograph that we have got, it's easy to reconstruct a scene like this. The mountains that you would have seen would have been much taller than what is shown in this picture, and we will discuss that issue by and by. But first of all, let us look at this object called Pluto. Pluto has had a very raw deal with astronomers from Earth in the last 10 years or so. We have demoted it, we have thrown it out, we have done all kinds of, we have called it names and so on, and we will look at first the issue about why Pluto has been so badly treated by astronomers, and then we will get on to the details about what New Horizons saw. If you look at the solar system, Mercury, Venus, Earth and Mars are of course inside. You get Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune, and then you get Pluto with a rather odd orbit. that actually brings it closer to the Sun than Neptune, and takes it much further away from the Sun in as parts of this orbit. Currently, when the New Horizons went to Pluto, the Pluto was somewhere over here, and that's how we've got some of the best results for Pluto. And if you had not used this opportunity, you would have lost it for another 200 years, because once Pluto goes farther away, it essentially becomes cold and barren, the sunlight becomes very weak, and therefore the fun is not there. And that is why there was a certain amount of desperation in flying to Pluto now, because it is essentially now or never. So let us first look at the planets and compare where Pluto stands. So if you look at the Sun, Earth is a rather small object, and Pluto in fact cannot even be put on this photograph because it is simply so small. So you have Earth, you have Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and so on. The Earth, about 108 Earths, 18 Earths would fit on the diameter of the Sun. That is how big the Sun is. Now that is magnitude of Sun with respect to the planets. If you take only Jupiter, then compared to the size of Jupiter, you have Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, Earth, Venus, Mars, Mercury, and eventually Pluto, and 11 Earths would fit on the diameter of Jupiter. So we are talking about large objects. Even if you take Earth as a standard, and you take Earth about this size, Venus, Mars, Mercury, even then Pluto turns out to be a fairly small object. We always knew Pluto was a very small planet, diameter of about 3000 kilometers, and we will take a look at it a little later. But essentially, solar power, Pluto is not a very large object. If you asked what the solar system looked like, say 200-300 years before Galileo, you would have got Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. These are the planets that you can see without the aid of a telescope. Then once telescope came up, we added in early 20th century Uranus and Neptune, and eventually about 40 years ago we added Pluto to the system somewhere over here. And then all hell broke loose, because Pluto does not fit into the standard format of planet. So if you look at the Earth, Mercury, Venus, Earth, and all the planets that move in a plane, Pluto in fact is 17 degrees off that plane. So that was the first problem. The second problem, of course, that it is very small. The third problem is that it has an inclination of 122 degrees. Now, it is not that we have not seen such bad inclinations. Uranus rotation axis, for example, points straight to the Sun. So, during its 1 year, for half the month, the North Pole faces the Sun. For the other half of the year, the South Pole faces the Sun, and so on. We have Venus, which is completely upside down. But by and large, the planets have a vertical axis. Compared to that, Pluto in fact is rotating at a very odd angle with respect to the Sun, at an angle of 17 degrees to the plane in which all the other planets sit. So we aren't very happy with all these things. But in fact, Pluto becomes more difficult because it has a whole host of objects. And in fact, now if you ask astronomers the name of Pluto, they won't call it Pluto anymore. They will call it object number 134340, because it is one of the minor objects of this solar system. So Pluto has a lot of problems. There are a lot of things that are different about Pluto. If you look at all the properties of planets, their mass, their diameter, their rotation axis, their distance from the Sun, their revolution period, their eccentricity, and their inclination. And what I have here is Mercury to Pluto and Moon over here. And the first thing that you notice is that Pluto is so small that it is 1/5, 1/6 the size of the Sun, even our Moon. It is 1/6 the size of our Moon, and by far the smallest object in this entire series. It is comparable, in fact smaller than Moon, like I said. Its diameter is 2200 kilometers against 1700 kilometers for Moon, and that is because it is fluffy and it is light. And that is why its diameter is slightly larger, but really it is not particularly, it's much more heavy, much lighter than Moon. Similarly, it rotates on its axis once in 6 days, and the only other planet that does something like that is Mercury, which takes 58.5 days. But otherwise, it is the, Venus. So it is the third slowest rotating planet in the solar system, and Venus, of course, has this odd number because its axis is completely tilted. And Mercury is an unusual object because it is locked to the Sun. So we know why Mercury behaves the way it does. We know why Venus behaves the way it does. But Pluto is unusually slow in its rotation. It takes 6.5 days for it to complete one rotation when everybody else does it in a matter of few hours. Even the giant Jupiter can do it in 10 hours or less, and Saturn does it in 10.5 hours. Its revolution period is 247 years, and that actually was very crucial in deciding to go to Pluto, because once Pluto moves out from the Sun, we wouldn't have had such an opportunity for another 200 years to see Pluto at its warmest and closest to the Sun. So we had to go to Pluto now or wait for 200 years. Its eccentricity is also very high, the highest of anything that you can think of. Its orbit is not at all circular, so at closest it gets much closer, and at farthest it gets much farther than what most planets would do. And the inclination, like I said, is 17 degrees from the plane of all the planets. If you compare Pluto with other moons of the solar system, you actually get an interesting result. We have our own moon over here, and the moons of other planets are over here, and Jupiter actually is smaller than even moons of most of the planets. Jupiter by any standards, Pluto by any standards is rather small, and what we would consider insignificant object in the solar system. And yet it became a planet. And the story of that is that at that time we didn't know better, and I'll come to the story of how we know better now. The other problem is that Pluto has a moon Charon, which is almost half the size of Pluto itself. So if Pluto is a planet, why is Charon not a planet? That's such an obvious question to ask, because the mass difference is very small. And if you look at Pluto and Charon, this is what the pre-Hubble pictures of Pluto and Charon look like. Now of course we know that not only Pluto sits over here, there is Charon, which is much closer to Pluto, and there are four more moons which go around Pluto. So Pluto seems to be not a planet in the way we believe in planets, which is the one huge gigantic important objects around which small little objects go around. Here you have a case where the planet to moon ratio itself is 1:2, and there are a whole bunch of small moons that go around Pluto, and you wonder whether Pluto is really the boss of the place. The other problem is that Pluto is part of a very big belt of objects that we now call Kuiper belt, and there are thousands of objects in the Kuiper belt. By the last estimate it was 11,000 or something, probably much more. And within these Kuiper belt objects, Pluto moves in a rather eccentric orbit. So thousands of objects, some of them comparable in size to Pluto, some of them as small as a few 100 meters or even smaller, make a whole belt of material which was left over when the solar system was born. So when the solar system was born about 4,500 million years ago, essentially all the inner material got coalesced, formed planets and settled down into planets. Pluto belonged to a class of objects that never succeeded in becoming planets, and there's a whole bunch of dust, or whole bunch of residual material that is lying in the outer region that we now call Kuiper belt. Such material would have been inside in the solar system also, except that over a period of time the planets ate it up and made the inner solar system rather clean, except for the asteroid belt, but the outer region remains as dusty as ever. And that is where the problem for Pluto starts, because Kuiper belt has at least another dozen objects which are of same size as Pluto. So if you have one planet, if you have solar, Pluto is a planet, you actually need to have 15 or 20 planets as part of the solar system. And if you do that, of course, the school children will kill us, as it is remembering 8 planets is difficult enough. Remembering 30, 35 planets would have been a disaster. Okay? They are also comparable to the size of Pluto, and even more are being discovered every day. Some of them, in fact, are in the inner solar system right next to the asteroid belt. So if we had to do that, if we had to look at the whole situation, you get a situation like this. You have the Earth over here, you have our moon over here, you have Pluto, which is 1400 kilometers, another one 800 kilometers, another one at 1100 kilometers, and in fact we have one which is by density, by weight, by mass, much heavier than, slightly heavier than Pluto, but by volume slightly smaller than Pluto. There is another object, and we would have to include all those into our solar system which means that our solar system would look like this. Okay? So you have Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune, and then you have a whole bunch of, there is one major asteroid belt object and a whole series of other objects that would make our solar system. This one lists 43 objects of Pluto size that would form the solar system. So essentially the solar system would look like this, with essentially ever increasing names and numbers at the bottom, which of course is a bad idea. So you can't really have, I mean, there is no way an astronomer would be able to go to school to teach after this, because the problem would become impossible. Also, there is no fun, in the sense that these large objects have subtly different physics than what the smaller objects have, and we will discuss those issues as we go by. But essentially, this is the reason: there were simply too many Pluto-sized objects to call the solar system. So eventually, we redefined our solar system. Now we have a much more precise definition of who is who in the solar system. A planet, by definition now, is a celestial body that meets the following condition. Firstly, it is sufficiently heavy that it must become spherical in its shape. So, a planet must be spherical in shape. If you have, the way planets form, they essentially are small pieces of rock which are simply caught onto each other and they become heavier and heavier. Now, normally they would remain deformed, they would have all kinds of shapes and sizes, but eventually at some stage they become so big that the pressure from outside forces them to become spherical. So if you want to be a planet, you should be so large that your pressure should make you become spherical. It should also orbit the star directly. It cannot orbit another planet and then along with the planet go around the star, because then you would call it a moon or you would call it a satellite. So it should not be a satellite of any other object. And the third condition is that it should be the dominant object in this region. Not say that I have four other moons hanging around with me, we are all of similar sizes. So either you make all of them planets or make none of them planets. We choose to make none of them planets in that case. And then there are basically two kinds of planets: Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune, which are giant planets, and Mercury, Venus, Earth and Mars, which are what we call classical objects, which are sufficiently close to the Sun so that they all have thin atmosphere. If ice exists, ice exists in such small quantities that it melts and moves around. In Venus, in Mercury, you don't even find enough water. But essentially, beyond Mars, you have this water line, where if you put an object, it is so cold that even ice, water would become ice and really solid ice, and a lot of other gases, including nitrogen and so on, will start becoming solid. So the outer gases, outer planets that you have are planets which are by size not particularly bigger than the inner solar system object, except that they have collected so many gases and are so fluffy and huge that you actually get them to be of much bigger size, consisting of outer layers of gases and so on. And then you have this Mercury, Venus, Earth and Mars, which are inside the Sun line, and therefore water will, you won't get huge quantities of ice covering several thousand kilometer layers in these inner planets, and so they are barren. You can see the rock. Well, in these cases you can't see the rock. And like I said, we know 8 objects of this class. And then there are minor planets. Everything else that is not planet is a minor planet. So we have dwarf planets. Pluto has been now reclassified as a dwarf planet, which means it's a medium sized object, may or may not be fully spherical, and it just needs to be reasonably spherical, and it should move around the star itself and not move around another object. And you can argue, for example, that Pluto and Charon probably should both deserve this kind of recognition and so on. They are essentially, those that are essentially beyond Pluto or beyond Neptune are called Plutons, just to make sort of a concession for Pluto. But essentially these are all dwarf planets. There are a handful of dwarf planets that are inside, but a large fraction of dwarf planets are actually beyond the orbit of Pluto. Plutons include Pluto and Xena, whose name now has been changed, which is slightly heavier than Pluto but slightly smaller in diameter than Pluto, and is now called Eris, and it also has its own moon and so on. We are officially, as of a year ago, we knew of 3 dwarf planets who are officially formally classified. The list will probably eventually settle at some 40 or 50 objects. And then there are satellites of planets, essentially objects that go around a planet, and the center of gravity they are so small that the center of gravity will fall inside the planet and they go round and round. The planet, the largest moon that we know is Ganymede of 5000 kilometers, and we know of about 150 satellites to various planets. And the last are all the residue that remains, every piece of junk, every piece of rock, every piece of dust that you can find is all classified as minor bodies of the solar system. So essentially this is what our solar system looks like. Now that because Pluto was there and Pluto forced us to ask a lot of questions about what is a planet and what is a solar system, so we now have a formal definition of what a solar system looks like. So solar system today looks like this. We have Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune as our planets. Three classified small planets. Ceres, like I said, is in the asteroid belt. Others are way beyond Neptune. Why waste our time studying Kuiper belt objects? That's an obvious question to ask. I mean, they are so far away that do you really want to spend time studying them? And one would think the answer would be no. But the reason my answer is yes is because when you look at the inner planets of the solar system, Earth, Mercury, Venus or anything close by, over the last 4.5 billion years that we have been around, meteors have fallen on Earth, earthquakes have happened, wind denudation has happened, water denudation has happened, rains have happened, human beings have changed the biosphere. So many things have happened that you can't get the original material of what solar system looked like when it began on the Earth at all, on any of these nearby planets. Even Mars, for example, is heavily reworked since its birth. Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune are essentially shielded by such a massive amount of fluffy material that you can't really access its inner material. So essentially if you want to look at good, old, original, pristine material from which solar system was born, you have to go to Kuiper belt objects. This is the first problem. Because even nearby asteroid belts, you have too many collisions and breakages and you won't be, and the sunlight is intense enough to change the chemistry, so you can't get the old pristine material. If you want to know what solar system was made up when it was born, you have to go to this part of the universe. And later on, if somebody has a question about what is so mysterious about the formation of the solar system, we'll take up that question a little later. Kuiper belt effectively is the outermost part of the solar system. Everything that was not here has remained there. Kuiper belt, like I said, by the last count, had 1100 objects which are being tracked, and the number of objects probably runs into tens of thousands or even more. It holds information of the farthest reaches of the solar system. It also records information about how solar system was formed. And as late as last week, there was some suggestion that maybe inside this, probably a very huge planet has been passing through because of the way things are getting disturbed over here. And it is highly perturbed. It is not a very stable system. You would think that in last 100 years, we have not seen anything spectacular in the solar system, so nothing really happens in the solar system. In fact, that is not true. Solar system is an extremely violent place. It so happens that we live only for 100 years or so, or even less, so we don't see much. But if you were to run into timescales of thousands of years, this is not a very pristine place to live in, and I'll show you the example in my last slide about what kind of things have happened to the solar system. So if you want to know what happened to the solar system, you really want to look at it. There is another suggestion of something called the Oort cloud, which is even further away at some 100,000 astronomical units compared to 50 astronomical units for Kuiper belt. And we suspect that there is something called Oort cloud over there, but we are not very clear that it can even exist. So we think studying Kuiper belt objects is good enough to get us an idea about what solar system looks like. Is Kuiper belt really real? Does it really happen? And you'd be surprised that if you see other solar systems being born, you actually see this kind of object. So here you have an example of two stars which are settling down into forming their planet, and you can see that this is the orbit of Neptune. So they have blocked out the sun to look at the disk, and the disk would, Neptune would probably end over here, but clearly there's a lot of leftover material that is being processed. Similarly, in this star, you can see the Neptune's orbit. Neptune would essentially be at the edge of this. The star has been artificially removed from this data, but you can see that a lot of residual material remains outside. So if you are worried about stellar systems, if you are worried about planets around other stars, if you are worried about where to look for planet, how to look for life, or any issues related to planet, you need to worry about Kuiper belt, because that seems to be a common feature of not just the solar system, but of all kinds of stars that are forming planets around themselves, and therefore it remains a point of interest. Coming to the Pluto itself, of course in 2006, we sort of punctured its ego and made it get out of the planetary system, but it still remains an interesting object. Okay? Everybody thought at the end of this day that Pluto was not going to be a particularly interesting object, until NASA decided to do something that everybody thought was a silly idea. Okay, everybody else who didn't have money and technology to do it decided that it was a silly idea, but anyway, NASA went around with this beautiful mission called New Horizon. In many ways, everybody said this was an impossible mission, because first of all, Pluto is so far and the signals from there are very weak. But anyway, on January 16, 2006, 9 years and counting, that Pluto, that New Horizons mission left for Pluto. Even then, even leaving in 2016 on the fastest possible space rocket that we could have, New Horizons was not fast enough to catch up with Pluto in the short time that, in the 9 years that it had. They had to give it an additional velocity. To reach Pluto, it needed velocity far in excess of what we could provide with Earth-bound our rocket systems. What they call rocket technology is just not good enough to make this mission fast enough. At about 2,400 kilometers in size and 4.7 billion kilometers away, the object of New Horizons left Earth moving at about 4.7 kilometers per second, which incidentally is the fastest velocity with which we have sent any payload, and yet it was not good enough. Because to give you an idea of scales, to go to Pluto is like trying to hit a hazelnut at 50 kilometers from where you are, when the hazelnut itself is moving at some 20 odd kilometers per second, and your bullet is also moving at some 5 kilometers per second, and that is also not good enough. So that is the kind of accuracy you need, that's the kind of speed you needed, and we don't have it. So what NASA did was even more cunning, and I'll just come to that in a minute. Pluto had just passed the closest point to the sun in 1989. I showed you the orbit of Pluto, which is highly elliptical. It was closest to the sun in 1989 and is now headed away from the sun and would not be visible for another 200 years. And so we had to send the mission either now or wait for 200 years, and nobody wants to wait for 200 years of course. NASA therefore used Jupiter to accelerate the payload by another 20 kilometers per second, okay? The fastest that we had when we managed after launch at 4.7 kilometers per second with acceleration, we had managed 16 kilometers per second. We needed 36 kilometers per second. So this 20 kilometers per second was added by using Jupiter as a slingshot. So the mission to Pluto never left for Pluto. It actually left for Jupiter. It went to Jupiter, took a major swing, got accelerated, and then it got the speed that it did. And remember the size scales that I told you. Okay? Jupiter is about 5 AU, 5 times the distance from the Earth to the Sun. Jupiter is that far, you have to go there, hit Jupiter, swing it past by, and then make it go to Pluto. We were very thrilled when Mangalyaan hit Mars. This is far more complex than anything that you can imagine. Okay? This is what the mission looked like. Looks like a piano if you wish. A huge antenna to communicate with the Earth and the various scientific instruments. The interesting thing is that this thing is hard fitted. In order to avoid excess power usage, the antenna is fitted to the body of the satellite, which means that when the satellite wants to communicate with the Earth, the entire this antenna should point to the Earth. A hazelnut at a distance of 50 kilometers. That is the kind of accuracy with which it must point to the Earth for Earth to get the data from the mission. That is the kind of accuracy you needed. And you had no ability to turn the antenna. You had to turn the whole satellite if you wanted to turn the antenna, and that would have meant fuel usage. There was no way they're going to use any fuel more than what was minimum required. And this is a technological marvel by any standards. I mean, there's nothing like this. That we have built other missions. Incidentally, this is not the farthest we have sent a mission. Voyager 1, Voyager 2, Pioneer 11, Pioneer 12 that left the Earth in 1970s have actually gone to a distance more than twice the distance that New Horizons has gone. But those objects were relatively dumb. Now, when you think about it, they were relatively dumb, because all they did was to keep on moving collected all the information that they got and sent it back on the Earth. They were never designed to go and hit a hazelnut at 50 kilometers. They were just designed to move, see whatever you can see, and keeps telling us back what you have seen. Compared to that, New Horizons was designed to go and point at a hazelnut 50 kilometers away. Okay? And that too after going through Jupiter and getting a swing by. About the mission itself, just to give you some raw data, 478 kilogram weight at launch, 7 instruments, one was a visible and infrared imager, one was the ultraviolet imager, then you had radio science experiments, REx, telescopic camera. Most of the images that you saw during the last month came from LORI, and then there is a solar wind and plasma spectrometer, there is energetic particle measurement device, and there is a space dust measuring device. These are devices that collect data all the time. LORI was the one that gave everything that it did, and we are expecting still more data from all these. The dimension is 0.7 meter at its smallest to 2.1 meter at its widest, and 2.7 meters when you consider the third dimension of this piano. It has one, the energy source, the sun, and even at 400 times the full moon is still not powerful enough, because if you wanted to power it by solar panel, the solar panel requirements would have become impossibly large. So they have put a small radioactive material, small amount of radioactive material in it, which heats up the water around it, and that heated water turns the turbine and produces the electricity that it does. So it's essentially designed entirely to run on a small amount of radioactive material, not the way we use in nuclear reactors. Nuclear reactors are a completely different ballgame. This is just a radioactive material that that produces heat, and that heat is used to take the thermoelectric heaters, not exactly steam turbine, but thermoelectric heaters to generate all the power that it needs, and it uses power less than a 60 watt bulb. Okay, the entire satellite and everything, including communication, uses power less than the amount of power you consume when you put a 60 watt bulb. That's how small the power consumption is. 240 watts, that is the maximum power it has. Now much further away, it is more like the scientific instruments essentially use 60 watt. The rest of the power is all goes into sending a signal strong enough for us to be able to hear on Earth. Its antenna diameter is 2.1 meters. The total cost of the instrument, of the satellite, including launch vehicle, mission operation, data analysis, education and everything together, is 700 million. It's a rather low cost venture by NASA standards, even if it means lots of money to us. To NASA, $700 million is not a huge budget experiment. What did the mission do? The mission left Earth on January 19, 2006. It flew by moon in a day at 189,000 kilometers. And this should give you an idea about the speed and the kind of capabilities we are talking about. Our Mangal Chandrayaan took 7 days to reach moon, because we could not give it the velocity it needed to go straight to the moon. The Earth's gravity was strong enough. So we used Earth's gravity as a slingshot 4 times before we eventually managed to sling it fast enough to reach the moon. Compared to that, in 1 day flat, the mission went straight out of the Earth's gravity, straight past moon into the interstellar space. While it was going along on June 13th, it came across a meteor, so it sort of looked around and saw what it could, but that was not a part of mission, it just happened to be on the way. Eventually, after a year, almost a little more than a year, it reached Jupiter and used gravity assist or the sling effect from Jupiter to accelerate it to the speeds that it wanted, and this was done of course at 2 million kilometers from Earth. And then eventually on July 14, it reached Pluto. The whole bunch of things that it did in the middle, I'm going to skip all those things, but the closest that it got to Pluto was 12,500 kilometers and then simply went by. But because it has power limitation, because it has a communication limitation, it is so far away and all that, during the true observation session of Pluto, the mission has not sent us any data. The mission collected data from July 10th till about 3 weeks time, just collected the data without talking to us, and now that it has gone beyond that point, slowly at a few kilobits per second, it is sending us all that data, and it will take us 16 months to eventually understand what, or at least get the data of what New Horizons saw when it was close to Jupiter, close to Pluto. When it was close to Pluto, it never talked to us. It simply collected all the data because it used all its power and all its energy to collect the data. And now, at a few kilobits per second, it is sending it to us. And it will take 18 months for the entire data just to be downloaded on Earth before we look at it. The pictures and all the physics and all the discussions that you see were of pictures taken before July 14. They had this telescopic camera, so they took quick shots much earlier, and those are the images. And even those images are enough to give you something exciting, and I will show you what is the exciting thing. This is what we now know of Pluto. This is what we knew of Pluto before New Horizons went. This is what the vague ideas, these are the vague ideas we had of Hubble Space Telescope. We could see a few spots moving here and there, on the basis of which we had concluded that it has that 6.5 day period of rotation and so on. But they were essentially fuzzy pictures, not exactly high quality. Now we have pictures which are 230 meter resolution, so we have phenomenally pretty pictures, and I'll show you what we have. It is slightly tilted, the North Pole is over here in this, and the equator, just below the equator there is a dark spot that we don't understand. Just be above, just crossing the equator is this heart-shaped object that we are not very clear about, and there are some more spots, and if you go to the back side, you would see this. Remember one thing, that Pluto, the images that we have got of Pluto are about a couple of days, over a period of couple of days, which means Pluto had not rotated. Pluto rotates once in 6.5 days. So in a couple of days, you essentially got the front view of what, the sun-facing side of Pluto, and this is what the backside picture of Pluto looks like. These black spots are not continuous, but there are still plenty of black spots over here. You see the equator over here, and the top seems to be a little smoother than the right. And this is a composite picture of Pluto and Charon together in a single frame. You can see immediately that Pluto is more yellowish or brownish in color. This object is grayish in color. This is one single picture of both Pluto-Charon system. You can clearly see that the color of Charon is very different from color of Pluto, and we'll come to that a little later. This is what Pluto and this is Charon looks like, 1/4 the size. It has some gray spots, but essentially the colors are different. And the colors are different for some fundamental reasons. The surface composition of Pluto is different from surface composition of Charon, because Charon is small. There are material like methane and so on which Pluto managed to hold on to, but which have evaporated away from Charon. So on Charon you don't see them because they have evaporated away. So you see the barren, you see basalt over here, you essentially see iron rock over here, and therefore it looks far more grayish than the brownish tinge that Pluto has, except that you see some white spot over here, black spot over here, which for some reason of curiosity is similar to the one on Pluto. So there's actually been a discussion as to whether the two are magnetically connected, or at least some way of physically connected, so that the winds from this Pluto are actually going and falling on Charon, and therefore wherever it falls on Charon's poles, you actually get a slightly color deformation than what you get for the rest of Charon's surface. So this probably is residual material from Pluto which is still being flung onto it, while this is the rest of Charon. If you look at, so when we went to Pluto, what were we expecting? We were expecting an object of 2370 kilometer diameter. It was probably the largest dwarf planet in the solar system, but not the heaviest. The heaviest is Eris, which is slightly smaller by about 30 odd kilometers, but it is 30% heavier than Pluto. So this, we had a vague suspicion that Pluto is not the heaviest object, even if it is the largest object in the solar system. Pluto's moon, Charon, is so close that the two seem to exchange gases, and there is a potential trace of gases from Charon that seem to have come from Pluto. The spot that I showed you seems to be Pluto material falling on Charon. There are very few meteors on Pluto, and much song and dance has been made about this, and I'll come to this specifically because this is a problem that has completely baffled us. Pluto has a surface temperature of minus 218 degrees centigrade to minus 240 degrees centigrade. It has a thin nitrogen atmosphere which probably freezes completely when Pluto moves away to real further. It also has mountains of 3.5 kilometers tall on its surface, which is completely unexpected. If you have mountains and if you don't have craters, you get worried. If you're an astronomer who sees a planet which has lots of mountains and no craters, you really get worried. And the reason why you get worried is because you would expect a lot of craters on Pluto. You can see them on Charon, and Charon is just right next to Pluto. So you would expect equal number of or larger number of mid-impact craters on Pluto, but you don't see them. I mean, that on its own would not be difficult. What that means is that either the surface has been covered by ice or that it has been scrubbed clean. On Earth, for example, we have very few meteor craters simply because the wind, weather, water, etc. has scrubbed and cleaned up the surface every time there has been a meteor impact. So there are only a handful of really large meteor impact craters lying on Earth. Most have been wiped clean. But to wipe them clean, you need essentially things like geomagnetic activity, you need Earth upheaval, you need tectonic plates, you need a whole bunch of things to really wipe these things clean. Now on Charon you see a lot of meteor craters, so obviously on Pluto you should have seen a lot of craters. And if they have been wiped out on Pluto, you have a problem. Because there is something happening inside the surface of a planet, born 4.5 billion years ago, 2700 kilometers of size, would have been completely dead and gone. All its internal heat and everything would have been lost by now, and therefore you don't expect anything on it. So where have the mountains gone? And that remains one of the most serious problems of Pluto, that we have no craters, but we have mountains. Because anything that destroyed craters would have destroyed the mountains. And if mountains have not been destroyed, or mountains still exist and craters don't, it means that the mountains must be new. And if the mountains are new, which means that mountains are being made on Pluto. And if mountains are being made in Pluto, like we have Earth's geomagnetic activity and plate tectonics, we should also have the same thing going on in Pluto, which is absurd because Pluto is simply too small, too far away, too old and too cold. Too old, too cold, too far away and too insignificant. It should have had no geological activity. If it doesn't have geological activities, it should not have mountains. If the mountains are old, then the meteor crater should have been there. There is no way of squaring the circle. That you have a place with lots of mountains but no craters. Or very few craters. Not no craters, but very few craters. And that remains the biggest puzzle of why, what is happening to Pluto per se and Kuiper object, belt objects per se. How do you make a planet like this? There are two ways of doing that, and I think that comes a little later, but I might as well give the story now. There are two ways of doing this. One thing is to say that somehow Pluto has been able to sustain its geological activity through magnetic field or whatever it is, like Earth does. Earth's interior is quite hot. The second thing to say is that maybe just as we have tides on Earth, we have tides on Pluto because of Charon and so on, and those tides are strong enough to give you plate tectonic activities of the kind that we see on Earth. So essentially, just as you have a full moon producing high tides, those high tides get frozen into mountains. That's one way of doing it. So one way of doing it is to say that Pluto has geomagnetic activity. The second thing to say is that it has the gravity of the moons is so strong that it is disturbing Pluto, in that case Pluto is much less sturdy than what you would expect it to be. And the third option is to say that Pluto is very new. That Pluto actually is not an old planet. That as recently as a few million years ago, some objects in Kuiper belt must have had a bang against each other, and Pluto must have been born. Either of the three suggestions have a problem. Okay? If Pluto and Charon are so close to have actually a wave-like effect on Pluto, we are talking about an interaction which we have not understood. Pluto and Charon are close to each other. Charon is reasonably heavy, that we know. It also has a pristine surface, we know, relative to Pluto. But whether it is strong enough to have winds waves and tides on Pluto, we don't know. Second thing is, those tides can only be created when Pluto itself is warm, which means it is close to the Sun. So it is quite likely that these mountains are as new as 1989 or so, when Pluto was really warm and gravity of Charon managed to produce waves and those high tides got frozen as mountains. But we don't know yet. If it is geologically active, then you have a problem because there is incoming sunlight on Pluto is so weak that it cannot warm up Pluto. So Pluto then must be have found a way of maintaining its heat inside itself in a manner we don't understand. Maybe the insulation layer on the top surface is so strong that the inner heat still remains. We don't really know how it can keep heat inside. And the third problem, if it is new, which means we are in a far more violent solar system than we used to think it is. Because anything that can break a huge object and make Pluto can easily throw a whole bunch of rocks off angle straight into the direction of the Earth, and therefore meteor showers would become far more common, and the probability of being hit by a Kuiper belt object becomes far higher for people on Earth, which is something of course we worry about. So whichever way you look at why Pluto has mountains and no craters, you actually have a problem on hand which we don't understand. This is what Pluto and Charon look like. Pluto probably has a core. We don't know whether it is warm, but if it is warm, then you have interesting issues. And then there are two layers of ice. Ceres, on the other hand, it simply has a thin dust crust, a bit of water ice, a water ice, but essentially it's a large rock. It is simply too small to be able to hold on to the kind of water that Pluto can hold on to. And Pluto incidentally is not, Pluto incidentally does not have water at minus 50 odd degrees centigrade, at this kind of temperatures, 55 degrees Kelvin or so, would be as hard as metal. You can actually cut it and strip it and make it into pieces of rock, except that ice remains brittle. It is not malleable. It is not a malleable metal, but it is as strong as a metal. You can make furniture out of ice. Well, you can make furniture out of ice. There are ice hotels even on Earth. You can certainly make furniture using this ice. So there's much ado about craters, like I said. If you only have mountains and no craters, then you either have to destroy the craters by somehow, or you can say that you are simply too young and therefore not many craters have hit you, or you can say you have geological activities. But whatever you do, you have a problem on hand, which is something we were not expecting when New Horizons went. We were not really expecting much by way of a new kind of understanding of planet formation until New Horizons went. Pluto, if it is young, then Kuiper belt is unstable, and we don't particularly appreciate that idea. This is what Pluto's mountains look like. They can be as high as 3.5 kilometers on a 3,000 kilometer planet. So we are talking about 10% the height. It's like saying that on Earth, for 12,000 kilometer diameter, we have 12,000 kilometer mountains. We don't. The tallest mountain we have is 8 kilometers or 9 kilometers. 9 kilometers on 12,000 kilometers of Earth. Well, you have 3.5 kilometers on a 3,000 kilometer planet. So they're huge by any stretch of imagination. And yet it is not all mountainous. Okay, there are completely flat valleys like these over here at the edge of the heart, if you wish, where you can actually see signs of ice flows, and you can see it would not be water ice, it would probably be methane ice or something like that, but which can flow and produce cracks exactly as you get a crack on a frozen lake on Earth. It's not ice in the sense of water ice, it is probably in the sense of methane and other liquids, but then having flowing liquids on the surface of a planet that far away is surprised by any stretch of imagination, is sensational by any stretch of imagination, but you can actually see a typical sign of liquid denudation at the edge of these kind of objects. And then you have the last of the great mysteries of Pluto. This is a backlit picture of Pluto. So New Horizons went behind Pluto so that it could see the glow of the sun reflected by Pluto, and you saw a whole ring of atmosphere. Pluto's atmosphere is much thicker than what we had expected. It is essentially nitrogen, it is largely nitrogen, some 90% is nitrogen, but it is not 100% nitrogen. And that means fun, in the sense that the simplest molecule that you can think of, which can remain gaseous at this kind of temperatures, is methane, CH4. And if methane exists on the surface, you have exciting possibilities, because even if methane is organic, old residue from the formation of the solar system, the fact that you can have hydrocarbons this far away per se is interesting, because we still don't know how life came on Earth. And life on Earth comes from carbon molecules. Now you can see exciting carbon molecules, 40 AU from Earth, in Kuiper belt objects, primitive, CH4, C2H5, not very large molecules, but you can see organic molecules on the surface, and you can see that near the equator you don't see much, but near the poles, which is lighted by the sun, you actually get a fair amount of methane on the surface of Mars. But that alone would not be a sensational mystery. The mystery is this, that if you take a profile of this atmosphere, you get Pluto's surface over here, and as you go up, the haze becomes lighter and lighter, as you would expect, which is what you would expect. There's nothing different about it except the numbers. The numbers are large. Above the surface of a planet, 2000 kilometers in size, at 80, 90 kilometers, if you see atmosphere in this kind of cold reaches, you really get caught by surprise. So Pluto's atmosphere is thin, but it has a significant atmosphere, unusual. Extending to 100 kilometers, it is rich in nitrogen, but it has traces of methane and other gases. Okay? And 100 kilometers is unacceptably large. Methane, ethane, acetylene, C2H2 and nitrogen are all seen in the atmosphere of Pluto, and you get ultraviolet light that comes from the sun. Together, they would produce a chemical reaction. So essentially, if you walk on Pluto, this is what you will see. These hydrocarbons plus nitrogen plus ultraviolet light means you start getting formation of heavier organic molecules, and those heavy organic molecules will essentially shower back on the surface of Pluto. But you would expect this to happen at about 70 or 80 kilometers of the surface of Pluto. You are suddenly seeing them happening at 90 or 100 kilometers above Pluto, and that is worrisome. That is worrisome in the sense that the atmosphere is much bigger. You have the surface of 40 degrees, 55 degrees Kelvin. It's extremely cold. You have nothing other than rare gases. 90% is nitrogen. Where is this atmosphere coming up? What is keeping up this atmosphere? Why is it going all the way to 100 kilometers? Are we making mistake in understanding how much light sunlight Pluto is accepting, how much sunlight Pluto is absorbing? If Pluto is absorbing much more sunlight than what we used to think it does, then why do you still see the kind of reflectivity that you see? If it is absorbing more and reflecting less, then our telescopes should have been invisible by now. And yet Pluto is beautifully visible from the Earth. It is reflecting a fair amount of light. And yet, it seems to be absorbing also a fair amount of light, so the numbers don't add up. There's something happening on Pluto that we don't know. If you look at the atmosphere of Pluto, when New Horizon reached there, roughly the surface pressure would be about a few millibar and constantly increasing. This is what you would have expected, and this is in some sense what you have seen from various other earlier studies. The other interesting feature is that the wind is so strong that if you look at Pluto over here, and the orbits of its five moons that go around it, and New Horizon goes right through it between Chiron and Pluto, you can actually see a shock wave, and you can actually see a swap of nitrogen molecules or atmosphere which is actually being drained away from Pluto. So if Pluto was not in a circular or elliptical orbit, you would have probably considered it as a comet or something of unusually large size, but essentially it has all the things. The shock it means essentially that the wind that is coming out from Pluto is at supersonic speeds. It is being blocked by the solar wind. So you have this beautiful shape, you have a lot of material that is going out, and SWAP has seen this material being thrown out of Pluto. So suddenly from an uninteresting far out object of no particular interest, Pluto has been of great surprise. And you can look at Charon, this is Charon, and if I did not tell you, you would probably think this is a picture of Mars with its great valleys and so on. It looks surprisingly similar to Mars. Look at the number of craters that you can see. So you have this crater, you have these great valleys that you see on Mars. You have far more number of craters than you have on Pluto, and you have this residual material coming from Pluto on this object. You really want to know what the hell this object is doing there. This is what the surface of crater looks like. Hundreds of meteor craters compared to what you see on Pluto. So where are those similar objects on Pluto, and we don't know the answer. In some sense, Pluto and Earth system is also very similar or not similar. Earth's atmosphere is also nitrogen, Pluto's atmosphere is also nitrogen. Earth to moon ratio is 1:4, Pluto's to moon ratio, Pluto to Charon ratio is 1:2. Moon and Charon are tidally locked. So the same phase of moon is seen to us, similarly the same phase of Charon is seen to Pluto, and in fact same phase of Pluto is seen to Charon. They both are kind of. Both are heavily cratered, both the moons are heavily cratered, both are grey in color for different reasons. One is because of basalt, the other is because of ice, and both moons probably form from impact of another bigger body. Pluto therefore has challenged us in many basic views of what solar system is, how solar system works, how the planets work, what is happening in the Kuiper belt. If Pluto-like collisions have occurred in the solar system recently, then of course you have a problem that Kuiper belt is not as stable as it was, and what is causing it to perturb, whether there are other objects moving into the solar system that we didn't know about, whether there are larger planets which we are missing, what is happening to the Kuiper belt, we don't know. And therefore, Pluto has created more problems than what we were hoping it would create. This is, for example, a picture of what happened. This is probably one of the ideas of floating about what happened to the solar system from its birth. What you have on x-axis, on y-axis, is the time. So this is 4.6 thousand million years ago. Since the birth of the solar system, this is today. The bottommost picture is the solar system as you see it today. Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, asteroid belt, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and then the Kuiper belt object. And this is how we suspect solar system looked like when it was born. Lots of little wriggles of nothing. In particular, the colors are given differently simply to help you track, but a whole bunch of disks like the one that I showed you for another star around in the universe. And then over a period of time, these objects coalesced into larger objects by about 3 million years since the birth of the solar system. And then they gradually settled down into Mercury, Venus, Earth and Mars, and then these asteroid belts remained. The interesting thing to note is that Jupiter was actually probably born out of material which was much closer to the sun. It actually moved much closer to the sun, and then because of angular momentum issues, it got curved eventually into orbit that it is around us by about 600 million years. Similarly, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune. But Pluto, by our best guess so far, is an object over here. So it probably came from somewhere inside and flew to the side. And there are some objects, Eric for example, could have come from outside and stayed over here. And you can see evidence of what is called the second late heavy bombardment. When there was a heavy bombardment of inner solar system objects around 900 million years after its birth. But you can see that things have been moving around in our solar system. We are not in a particularly quiet or uninteresting place. And in fact, if you look at some of the simulations, you would see even today's situation simulation. You have Sun, Mercury, Venus, Neptune, Uranus, Saturn and Jupiter. And you can see how their orbits would have changed over a period of time, and Neptune probably actually eventually dispersed all the objects in the Kuiper belt into a much larger belt. The bottom line is that Pluto probably is much younger than what we used to think it is, and it is still tidally connected to Charon, which gives its mountain, but is able to clean up its meteor impact craters. Pluto probably, if it is so young, it can easily be destroyed, and therefore Pluto probably may not even last very long. The rest of the solar system has been around for 4,500 million years. Pluto probably won't live that long. It is likely that Pluto-like systems are being continuously formed in the outer solar system. So these dwarf planets seem to be a transient story in the long story of solar system, and that we live in a rather violent solar system. At the end of the day, having given some kind of a picture, it's worth remembering that science is limited by what we think is possible, but nature can always come up with surprises that we had never thought of. So it's worth looking at Pluto again, except that for 200 years, we're not going to get much more data except the 16 months of data that New Horizons will send out, because nobody has the courage to send another mission or even an incentive, because now Pluto has gone off into the colder phase, to send a mission to Pluto. Pluto on Pluto. Thank you very much.